Well, I think we can slowly begin. So, hi everyone. My name is Verónica Mota. I live in Berlin since almost two decades, and my life is basically sound and music, and also teaching. I am very, very thankful with DICE, with this program, DICE Rising, which is it's really a fantastic program that they put together. And this is why I am here today, sharing with you and spreading knowledge about music from a POC and LGBTQ plus perspective. As I said, my background is basically sound art, sound design, electroacoustic music, music. I also sometimes do DJ. I'm starting producing a little bit of more danceable rhythmic music, like electronic body music. And I come from musicians. My grandfather was a musician and my brother is a musician. I have many people in my family that are musicians. So music is for me really my life and it's in my genes. And I spend a lot of my time and love sharing knowledge about the history of music. And this is again another workshops, another workshop from all the workshops that I give. And I normally operate as part of Urban Arts Berlin. I am the founder of Urban Arts Berlin. But I work with different people, with different organizations, for instance, in this case, DICE. And yeah, I hope that you enjoy the workshop and the conference. For me, it's a pleasure to be here, and I made everything with a lot of love and a lot of passion. So let's begin. Sorry, I'm still into the getting used to the, hope you can see my window, but I think you cannot see it yet. Okay, let's see if I can enter. Okay, here we go. I hope you can see the screen. If not, Daniel, if you can text me via WhatsApp, that will be fantastic. We begin with why we talk about POC and LGBTQ history. Why is it important? When we learn about music, we mostly learn from a colonialistic and homophobic and transphobic perspective, which does not credit the work and even denies visibility to minority groups. Our mission is to make visible some true pioneers from minority groups who gave birth to relevant sonic movements. This is the mission that I have given this workshop. I think, as you will see in what I will be talking about, there are many people who were not, who lost visibility or who are not mentioned in the archives. I follow different archives, and a couple of years ago, I began giving workshops about music. And when I was looking at certain archives that are extremely important for teachers and researchers like myself, I was really, really surprised that in the archives, I'm talking about 6-7 years ago, you had a long list, and mostly of the lists were full with white males. And you could see barely a female identified person, a woman. And of course, the LGBTQ plus were not even there, you know. And for me, was it's my battle since years to bring visibility to minority groups, because as you will see, they are fundamental for the cultural production, and we need to rescue those voices. And for me, this is the work that I am doing with this type of workshops, which is to share knowledge and to rescue the voices that have been ignored and not been visible in the archives. So let's give them visibility. we begin with a very important character, Sister Rosetta Tharpe. She was a very important person for, we wouldn't be here, the people that come from underground backgrounds like myself. In my case, it was punk music, punk subcultures. Without Sister Rosetta Tharpe, we wouldn't be here. She is the grandmother of many different underground movements, and you will see why. Sister Rosetta Tharpe, she was a US American singer, songwriter, guitarist, and recording artist. Mostly of the people that I will be presenting to you today, there are people who have, who work like creative octopuses, meaning they do different things at once, not at once, but I mean they are extremely talented and they do different things. And she was Rosetta, Sister Rosetta was one of them. She began doing gospel at churches at the age of 6. So she began making music in a very, very early age as a child. To contextualize, in the time when Rosetta was active, a kid and a teenager and later on in her life, for a Black person, an Afro-American person in the States, the only chance to produce music or be involved with music was through the churches, you know, because there was segregation and it was a very, there were very, very painful times that we should to keep in mind as part of the context of Sister Rosetta. This context is also, as you will see, the context in which she was operating. She was extremely radical for her time, also for the Black community. She was just a Molotov. She was doing a unique mixture of spiritual lyrics and rhythmic accompaniment. She mixed like gospel style with jazz and electric blues. Here, it's very important to notice that when I say electric blues, we are talking about electric guitar. And that was at that time very, very radical. She developed herself a guitar technique, which was first ever, she was the first person ever using guitar distortion. And this implies that all the people later doing rock and roll and punk and even metal, all these guitar distortions, the person that create this technique is an Afro-American middle-aged, you will see a video, woman. And that's extremely important to recognize and to acknowledge. She was imitated by men such as Little Richard. There is Little Richard is for the rock and roll corner, like the most important star for rockers. Many people were imitating Little Richard. And the history that many people do not know is that Little Richard was very like a teenager when he met Sister Rosetta Tharpe. And Sister Rosetta was a very strong, talented lesbian. And she saw Little Richard and she was like thinking, this guy is very talented, you know? And she was telling him, she invited him to play with her and share a stage. And she told him that he was very talented and that he should be keeping on making music. And he saw how she was playing guitar, the guitar distortion, and he imitated her. Also she was basically her mentor. And Little Richard inspired all these guys, but he was actually imitating Rosetta. And from this corner, we have Johnny Cash, Kyle Perkins, Chuck Berry, even Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Eric Clapton, Jeff Beck, and Keith Richards, also the big, big legends of rock and roll, they all wouldn't exist if it wouldn't be for Sister Rosetta Tharpe and her guitar technique, which is the guitar distortion. So we can consider Sister Rosetta Tharpe the godmother of rock and roll as well as the grandmother of punk. Ah, before we go here, before we will move to Sun Ra, I wanna introduce to you Sister Rosetta. This is a video from 1864. Rosetta was, as I told you, a Molotov. And this is a video that she recorded, that someone recorded when she was playing. She was invited to play in the United Kingdom in Manchester. And there she is performing. This, by the way, this concert was extremely important for the rock and roll scene in the UK.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I take great pleasure in bringing to you one of the greatest, one of the world's greatest gospel singers and guitar virtuoso, the inimitable Sister Rosetta Tharpe.
In the summer of 1964, in the pouring rain, from a disused railway station outside Manchester, a 49-year-old African-American woman with an electric guitar appeared on British television. Viewers had never seen anything quite like it. With her distinctive style of singing and playing, this remarkable performer would profoundly influence the course of popular music.
Didn't it rain? Rain, oh yes, didn't it? Yes, didn't it? You know it did, didn't it? Oh, oh yes, how it rained. I said it rained, children. Rain, oh yes, didn't it? Yes, didn't it? You know it did, didn't it? Oh my Lord, how it rained.
She had a guitar that was made of steel. And it was loud. And she would just get on this one string and start banging on it. And look, the people would go crazy.
She could play a guitar like nobody else. Nobody.
I think Rosetta was a hugely important figure.
Let's ride it.
You know, she was really unique as a guitar player. She had a big influence on somebody like Chuck Berry, who was one of the most influential guitar players in the world.
She did incredible picking. That's what really attracted Elvis, was her picking. And he liked her singing too, but he liked that picking first because it was so different.
Don't you know now this train is a clean train? Everybody ride it in Jesus' name, because this train is a clean train.
So as you can see, Rosetta was a total legend, and her technique was extremely important for today. I want to show you also another video about Sister Rosetta, because it's very important and very interesting, the context of that, of those days. And let's have a look a little bit to her biographical context and how radical she was.
We couldn't stay in some hotels. We had to sleep on the bus. So the bus was really a good idea. Being on the road with Sister Rosetta was very exciting, because sometimes we met opposition and sometimes we met gladness.
Food and hotels, restaurants, all of this, they were all the same. Water fountains, bathrooms, everything was segregated. They had to, as my father used to say, make do.
Jesus is the holy light, turning darkness
in. We would go in and eat, and we knew that she didn't have food on the bus, you know, or maybe she had crackers or cheese or, you know, peanut butter or something like that. But we would take what we ordered, we would get her the same thing and take it to her.
Oh, every day.
Sometimes you found someone that took a chance and said, come around to the back door, and they would serve us. But we had to bring it back to the bus still. We couldn't eat it there.
Up above my head.
Up above my head.
I hear music in the air.
I hear music in the air.
Now up above my head.
Up above my head.
By the age of 30, Rosetta had survived two brief and unhappy marriages and had had numerous affairs with men and women. The only constant person in her life was still her mother, Katie Bell. However, in the spring of 1946, she encountered a young singer called Marie Knight. She was so impressed by her, she suggested they team up. And together they recorded a hugely popular version of the gospel classic, Up Above My Head.
One of the things that made Marie and Rosetta so special as performers is that they were two women who could go on the road without any accompaniment but themselves. Marie was a piano player and percussion player. Rosetta performed on the piano as well as the guitar. And so the two of them together had their entire band with them.
Up above my head.
Up above my head.
I hear the music in the air.
I hear drums in the air.
Up above my head.
Marie Knight and Sister Rosetta Tharpe were a perfect pair. The music was so wonderful that they generated together. They were so unified on a stage. Together, they could rock the house.
Back then, two women on the road together without any men to accompany them was not only novel, but pretty risky. But it was a risk that Rosetta was prepared to take.
They were lovers, at least according to many, many of their friends at the time. Within certain circles, they could probably be a little bit open about it, but obviously within the wider world, that would have ruined careers, it would have ruined reputations. But I think it was an open secret in the entertainment worlds in which they moved.
In 1950, while Rosetta and Marie were performing in California, Marie's mother and two small children were killed in a fire. Traumatized by the loss, Marie drifted away, leaving Rosetta to carry on alone. Their dream of independence together was over. Less than a year after breaking up with Marie, Rosetta took the most outrageous decision of her life when two concert promoters came up with an audacious publicity stunt. Their plan was to stage Rosetta's third wedding in Washington's huge Griffith Stadium. They would sell tickets to her fans and the recording rights to Decca. Rosetta agreed to go along with the plan. But there was just one problem. She had no one in mind to marry. But just weeks before the big day, she found Russell Morrison, a minor player in the music industry who offered to be both her third husband and her manager.
Tell the truth, I was surprised when she said she was getting married and Russell was going to be the groom.
So she records her wedding ceremony and a concert that follows it in 1951. 25,000 people come out and pay admission prices to attend her wedding. They bring wedding gifts for her, they bring crystal, they bring dishes for her. Someone even buys her a television set. It's a total showbiz move. And at the same time, it's a wedding ceremony conducted by a minister, a real wedding ceremony.
Rosetta was standing on the pitcher's mound, and they had everybody around her and all of the matrons of honor and all these other people who were probably folks that the promoters got together. But they were all there, and it was just a wonderful, wonderful show.
I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you to Griffith Stadium, where you're about to be guests at the wedding of Sister Loretta Tharp, after which there'll be a great spiritual concert followed by fireworks. And now...
Okay, we continue because of the time, but Rosetta was really a very important character, and very important is to say that we're talking about the 50s and we're talking about the time of segregation, and she was so radical and she inspired so many people, including myself. Let's move on to another very important legend, which is Sun Ra. I'm sure that many of you probably know Sun Ra, which is Sun Ra, you know, it comes from Egypt, the Egyptian culture. He was totally into Egypt and the mystics of Egyptian culture. Sun Ra means god of the sun. And this is a very, very important name because it refers to all his philosophy. He had a very important philosophy behind his music. It was not only about changing the course of music, but also the mission about humanity itself. So for Sun Ra, things were more than only music, as we will see now. Sun Ra, as many of you probably know, is a US American composer. He was a band leader, a piano and synthesizer player, and also a poet. He is one of the pioneers of Afrofuturism. I want to give a conference about it as well because it's very, very important. He was into esoteric cosmic philosophy, experimental music, poetry, and theater. For Sun Ra, the expressions through costumes and body movement was extremely relevant. So for him, he uses the techniques of theater mixed with music and poetry to create a cosmogony, basically. He used to claim that he claimed to be an alien from Saturn with a mission to preach peace. He talks in his philosophy, he talks a lot about the personal nemesis, which is basically the meaning of balance in life, and also the process, the alchemical process. If you are into mysticism, this is the alchemical process, which is from darkness to light, and also the meaning of ethics of justice. He will influence later on, as we will see, more Mota, which is the contemporary stone for contemporary Afrofuturism. Sun Ra advocates for mind and spiritual expansion. He talks about how we have absolutely no limits and how we as human beings need to go beyond our limits. And that's, for me, extremely, extremely inspiring. I wanna share with you an example of, introduce to you Sun Ra, a documentary about him. just so you get to know him better. It is very important for me when I am giving a conference and a workshop to show you historical archives and historical materials, because this way you can really get close to the time, close to the historical context, and also you can listen a little bit to the music production, and then you can have a more rich full perspective about what we are talking here. By the way, if anyone has any question, you can formulate it in the chat, and at the end of the conference, maybe we can go through a couple of questions. You are welcome to post your questions in the chat. So let's meet Sandra.
Planet Earth can't even be sufficient without the rain. It doesn't produce rain, you know. Sunshine, it doesn't produce the sun. The wind, it doesn't produce the wind. All Planet Earth produces is the dead bodies of humanity. That's its only creation. Everything else comes from outer space, from unknown regions. Humanity's life depends upon the unknown knowledge is laughable when attributed to a human being.
Mythology, astro timeless immortality, astro thought in mystic sound, astro black of outer space, astro natural, darkness dark, astro reach beyond the stars, out to endless, endless death. Astro Black Cosmo Earth. The universe is in my voice. The universe speaks through this song to those of Earth and other worlds. Listen, while you have the chance, find your place among the stars. Equational melody, horizons beam, astro black and cosmo dark, astro black and cosmo dark, astro black and cosmo dark.
One day it will happen, could be happening now, that a voice from another dimension will speak to Earth. You might as well practice and be prepared for it.
Darkness
and darkness was ignorance. Along came wrong. When the world was in darkness and darkness was ignorance, along came wrong. The living men, the living men,
the living men,
the living men,
the living men,
I have many names, names of mystery, names of splendor,
names of shame.
I have many names. Some call me Mr. Ra, others call me Mystery. You can call me Mr. Mystery.
I want to rescue something about Sondra because Sondra is really, really a fan of Egypt and the idea of the sun and the idea of the light and the idea of basically pantheism. This is very, very important when we talk about Afro-American folks because this type of work is extremely revolutionary. Because this is these people that are already being themselves, being intellectuals, actually. Sondra is also a legend in the music history that I respect a lot because many of these legends that are pioneers of electroacoustic music in popular level, but also in like academical level and even in theoretical level. These people are very, very valuable because they don't only work with sound and music, they also work as they do political activism. Sondra, for instance, was supporting a lot the Black movement in the 60s. And he also did certain critiques to the Black culture, Black Afro culture. And I think this is what I rescue again and again from these pioneers when I teach about electroacoustic music, which is like there have been many, many ancestors from us who have done amazing work. And what I rescue about these people and what I value the most is that they are not only in the ego trip as artists, they are also doing social political work. And that's very, very important to point out. That's why the list that I put for this workshop is also acknowledging and recognizing the immense amount of political work that these people are also doing. Just by the fact of being present on the stage as a Black person, just by the fact of publishing books and ideas, and also, for instance, in the case also of Sondra, Sondra had her orchestra, which is an orchestra, and he was always also working in collective terms. So also not only thinking about me, like today, for instance, when we have techno producers, I like techno, but you have this little I, you know, the individualistic person and people adoring this individuum. We are now in a moment, in a historical moment in which the person, the I, is extremely valued, you know? And I think we should go back a little bit to this type of people in which they were working as we, not as me, adore me, but as more as a collective. And for me, that's something very important that is missing today in many musicians, like for on one side to have radical content, and on the other side also to work for the collective evolution, progress. This could be debatable, of course, if we go into philosophy terms, but I think socially talking, they are doing very, very important work. Let's continue with them. With Sunra. Thank you, Sunra, for your excellent work. Let's move to Pauline Oliveros. Pauline Oliveros, she's a Texan person working mostly with accordion and voice, and her work is also extremely appreciated in the terrain of electroacoustic music. And important to mention about Pauline Oliveros is that she also gave a lot of knowledge, and she was also an educator. And that's also another point that I want to rescue about this type of people, that they are doing so much work, including the socialization of knowledge. They are teachers, they share what they learned. And that's something also that I find very important from these characters, that they spread the knowledge. Pauline Oliveros, it's also a kind of a, also a post, more or less, post, no more or less, more, is, sorry, it's a post-war composer, which could be called, we are talking about lesbian musicality. She was lesbian. Also the lesbian listening and the lesbian subjectivity. There was many, many years in which Pauline was not acknowledged as a lesbian person until someone was researching her and writing about her more from the LGBTQ perspective, which I am doing myself now as well. She is, as I mentioned before, a pioneer on the post-war experimental music. She's also into improvisation and electronic music. That's why the workshop is called Electroacoustic Music. She is the founder of the concept deep listening and sonic awareness. These type of concepts like deep listening and sonic awareness, if you think about it, it sounds very Buddhist, Zen, and kind of, pretty much like very spiritual, you know? And that's also another thing when you meet these giants, that they have a very strong and deep philosophy also going on behind their composition. She also was, for her was also very important, the idea of female community building. We will see a quotation, I will put it in a sec. She's also a person that you can consider in this corner when you are checking out the archives, the relationship between gender and music. There is a book that I would recommend for you to check out, which is, it's called Sounding Out, Pauline Oliveros and Lesbian Musicality by Marta Mokus. If you can find out that book, I really, really recommend it to you because it's an extremely good book. Here, there is a quotation by Ellen Waterman, who was in a circle surrounded by a group of women. And within the circle, there was Pauline Oliveros as well sitting there. And they were talking about the written book about her and compositions and music and community. And I quote, "We need to keep on talking about women, but gender and sexuality," she tells us, Pauline says, no? "Because We are traveling in the long, hard road toward true respect and equality for women in music. This work, which she has been laboring at since the 1950s, is by no means finished. And this is also another thing. When I used to look at the archives researching different legends in music, I remember once going to this link from Ubu Web, which is a very important archive for academics and researchers. And I remember just like looking for electroacoustic music pioneers. And there comes the first, this is a list from, I think, 2005. And I came to this list and you see there like, it's full on the list, you know? And I was wondering, like, on the list, you could only see like from 200 names, you could see only three women mentioned, you know? And I was very, very shocked. I was like, again, what I was saying already before, I was thinking, oh my goodness, so many people have been erased from history, and that's a huge problem. But let's continue and let's get to know now Pauline Oliveros with her. This is a talk that she was giving on TED Talks and in 2015. And she talks about the difference between hearing and listening. Let's listen to it. Let me just check if we are, I hope we are fine with the sound.
Why would three musicians squeeze through a manhole-sized opening with their instruments to climb down a 14-foot ladder into a dark underground cistern? For us, echo and reverberation can be fascinating. Consider what fun it is to sing in the shower. Perhaps it brings out our inner Narcissus. The balloon pop you heard represents the remarkable 45-second reverberation time in the Dan Harpole Cistern in Port Townsend, Washington State, where the three of us played the music that is sounding now. The meme, deep listening, occurred to me after our recording in the cistern. We had come there to experience the unusual sound. Recording was really an afterthought that resulted in the release of Deep Listening by New Albion Records in 1989. And that was the birth of Deep Listening Band with Stuart Dempster, Paniotis, and myself. In order to play in the cistern environment, we had to learn to listen in a new way. We had no plan, no written score, and had no discussion beforehand. We simply improvised, played, and learned that the cistern was playing with us. We had to respect the sound that was coming back to us from the cistern walls and include it in our musical sensibility. All this was unspoken and simply experienced by the three of us. We chose Deep Listening as a title for the CD and band. We were all incurable punsters, and we created the music so deep underground. The practice of deep listening, as it has developed, explores the difference between hearing and listening. The ear hears, the brain listens, the body senses vibrations. Listening is a lifetime practice that depends on accumulated experiences with sound. Listening can be focused to detail or open to the entire field of sound. Listening is a mysterious process that is not the same for everyone. Humans have developed consensual agreements on the interpretation of sound waves delivered to the brain by the ears. Languages are such agreements. To hear and to listen have a symbiotic relationship with a questionable common usage. We know more about hearing than listening. Scientists can measure what happens in the ear. Measuring listening is another matter, as it involves subjectivity. We confuse hearing with listening. For example, music schools program ear training classes, but the ear can't be trained. What really happens is a cultivation of musical mind. I differentiate to hear and to listen. To hear is the physical means that enables perception. To listen is to give attention to what is perceived, both acoustically and psychologically. Hearing turns a certain range of vibrations into perceptible sounds. When listening, there is a constant interplay with the perception of the moment compared with remembered experience. Listening, or the interpretation of sound waves, then, is subject to time delays. Sometimes, what is heard is interpreted anywhere from milliseconds to many years later or never. So what did we learn from the cistern? Learning to listen to the cistern space led to listening more closely to all performance spaces and beyond. Each space is different and couples with instruments and voices to sound differently. Performance space is as important as voices and instruments. Formation of deep listening band led to deep listening retreats, workshops, lectures, concerts the world over, and now to the new Center for Deep Listening at Rensselaer that hosts scholars and conferences on deep listening. Deep listening came from 14 feet underground to higher education. So what is deep listening? Acoustic space is where time and space merge as they are articulated by sound. Deep has to do with complexity, boundaries, or edges beyond ordinary or habitual understandings. The subject is too deep for me, or she is a deep thinker. A subject that is too deep surpasses one's present understanding, or has too many unknown parts to grasp easily. A deep thinker defies stereotypical knowing, and it may take either a long time or never to understand her. Deep, coupled with listening, or deep listening for me, is learning to expand perception of sounds to include the whole space-time continuum of sound, encountering the vastness and complexities as much as possible. Simultaneously, one ought to be able to target a sound or sequence of sounds, perceiving the beginning, middle, and end of them as a focus. Such focus and expansion means that one is connected to the whole of the environment and beyond. My practice is to listen to everything all the time and remind myself when I am not listening. I invite you to take a moment now to notice what you are hearing and to expand your listening to continually include more.
This is very, very, very beautiful from Pauline, because as I told you before, these pioneers have a very strong philosophies. And when we are, for instance, considering the approach of Pauline Oliveros in electroacoustic music, you will realize that her concept of deep listening is also very political, particularly if we talk about our times or in any time, basically. We need to, I think what our society needs is what Pauline is suggesting, which is more deep listening. You know, like we need to really start a little bit more, being a little bit more quiet and listen, particularly practicing also active listening, which means listening to others and getting out a little bit of ourselves and being just quiet. She was also a person that is very important for meditations. She was doing a lot of workshops in which she was teaching people how to meditate through ambient sounds. And that's also a very important experience as a human being. Meditation, why? Because meditation puts you in a state of mind of calmness. You learn how to be calm. You learn how to be not doing anything at all, you know, just to be. And also that includes just to listen, you know. And today that we are living in a very technological matrix in which with the news, with Facebook, Twitter, and all these platforms, there is so much technological and informational noise going on that we are becoming, and also with the pandemic, it's just crazy, you know? We are becoming extremely isolated, extremely individualistic, sometimes not because we even want to, but there's a situation that we are at the moment. It has its positive aspects, of course, like this workshop. But in general, there are important questions about why not to meditate, turn the phones off, the computers off, and just like put some ambient record and do nothing and just listen. Or also when we are trying to build up community, it is so important to listen to each other, to give space to others, and also to acknowledge the other, their pain, their experiences, their what they have to give to the universe, as Sonra was mentioning now, because he's a defender of pantheism. God is everywhere, and each person is a star, you know. That's Afrofuturism as well, you know, like considering human beings as stars. Everyone is a star, and this is something that I am very that I have a lot of passion for. When I see all these guys, all these pioneers, all these legends, and I realize that their research and their philosophies are so inspiring still for us today. You know, there are things that I think we should rescue from the older generations. We continue. Another of my faps. John Cage, I give also another workshop on electroacoustic music, and my students, probably some of them are today here. I always mention John Cage. I also have a lot of love to the sonic production from John Cage, because it's another person that transformed the world through sound practice, and also he has his own philosophies, which we are gonna check now about. Also, John Cage is a pioneer for the avant-garde music practice and the non-standard use of instruments. There is an application that I personally use, which is called the broken piano. You can buy it, it's very cheap. And this application was made out of John Cage. The father of John Cage used to repair pianos, you know? He was a piano player, and So he was surrounded, John Cage was very a lot in contact with broken pianos. And he developed a technique basically find in broken pianos sound art. And even if the pianos were broken or he was still finding the beauty in these pianos. And there is, as I say, an application that you can find. And it's very beautiful, this application, what they did with the songs that John Cage was playing with. He was also a radical inventor. Because as I say, her father was also repairing pianos. So John Cage grew up also with this influence by his father. He developed the technique of broken piano, and he is also into the Zen Buddhist philosophy, the philosophy of silence. He was one of the first composers, if not the first one, who introduced silence into one of his compositions, which is this very famous piece called 433 minutes. It's a classic from John Cage, and in this piece he includes a part in which there is silence, and he talks about how a silent moment, it's also musical. That's also music, you know. And this is, if you move in that terrain of spirituality, you will understand the deepness of that approach, you know, like how to be silent is basically the state of spirituality. And he was trying to include spirituality in all his work. He was also an excellent cook, and he was a fan. He loved cooking mushrooms. And eating mushrooms, not magic mushrooms. Maybe he loved also magic rose mushrooms, I don't know. But he used to cook mushrooms a lot. He was also very relevant for the development of modern music. You will see a video that I will show you. But also modern music. He was a person also that influenced what I call the underground movements like punk, with the idea about when he was saying that everyone can play an instrument, everyone can play music. And this is for the time when he was around. This is very radical to say, because at that time, that's always what I teach to my students. At that time, music, particularly classic music and this kind of avant-garde music that was around, it was very elitist, you know, particularly classic music. It was extremely elitist. You have to learn decades in order to be acknowledged as a proper musician. And John Cage is a person that comes and says, everyone can play music and everyone can play an instrument, just do it. And that's an approach that punk music took from John Cage, which is the idea, okay, you want to play some punk, just grab your guitar and experiment with it. And off you go. There you are already making music. And that's something very extremely relevant for the time. It's extremely radical. Of course, many people from the elite of music were like, you are crazy. You cannot say that everyone can play an instrument. We have learned from decades. And he was very, very radical, because he was into the socialization of knowledge, you know, and also he was into destroying hierarchies. And that's something that's a huge gift that John Cage gave to us. And that's why I call him the father of punk and underground movements. Now I wanna play you a video from John Cage. This video that I'm gonna show you is also part of my lessons. The composition is called Water Walk. It's a composition that he made, and it was presented in the 1960s on the popular TV show, I Have Got a Secret in New York City. And here a couple of informations that are important. This show was very popular. It was a popular show, you know, and everyone was watching it. And he got invited to play the water walk in the show. And he, you cannot imagine how radical it is to go into a show where you are gonna be streamed in national TV. You are gonna be watched by thousands of human beings that are not into avant-garde music, electroacoustic music, into the, you know, academic or elitist intellectual music. He decided to run the risk because of his approach of socialization of music. And he went to this show and you will see what happened. And I'm not gonna say anymore anything else. We can talk after the video.
Water walk because it contains water and because I walk during its performance.
That figures, doesn't it? All right, now also two things I want you to notice. Over here, Mr. Cage has a tape recording machine, which will provide much of the, will you touch the machine so that we can know where it is, which will provide much of the background. Also, he works with a stopwatch. The reason that he does this is because these sounds are in no sense accidental in their sequence. They each must fall mathematically at a precise point. So he watches his watch as he works. He takes it seriously. I think it's interesting. If you are amused, you may laugh. If you like it, you may buy the recordings. John Cage and Water Walk.
Thank you.
Yeah, that is a classic performance from John Cage in the 60s. And you cannot imagine how brave John Cage was to, in so many levels, because he was breaking absolutely the rules about how do you play music, what is the meaning of music at all. And at that time, as you saw in the video, people were just laughing. And he also was laughing. And I find that also he's a character that was very, very modest. John Cage had this type of personality that it's a very humble, very, very humble spiritual person as well. And he was very, very radical at the beginning. By the way, not to forget, he was also homosexual. That's also an important information, not because I want to stigmatize the person, but because it is important to see how the LGBTQ perspectives and also the POC perspectives come out in sound and music practice, because the people come from certain minorities, and how these minorities produce and research and deconstruct the mainstream and the heteronormativity and all the, you know, like the rules and the structures. And they are very, very radical, because I believe they themselves are in a process that is very important to acknowledge. And I think they break so many things, so many rules and so many structures and so many perspectives and taboos. And they are so radical because of that. Their voices, coming from minorities, have a completely different perspective. And the result of their research is very, very radical because of that. And that's why I am very passionate about these people as well. For instance, John Cage, when he is socializing the idea of music production. In this video, you can see that he makes a composition called the Water Walk with objects in the house, you know, with glass, with water in a bath, you know, with ice, with machines, you know, like the how is it called, the mixing machine, and he even put flowers and you know, and this is for him, this video, he's basically saying like, look, music is all around you every day. The only thing that you have to do is to be silent. It's all around you. And also, you don't need to have the most expensive saxophone or piano or synthesizer, you know. You can already create music with, for instance, you can create a loop with your running water in the toilet, you know. And in that sense, this is, I really love the work of John Cage, because he breaks hierarchies. He gives music to everyone. He's like, music is something universal. It's a universal language. It's not only for the chosen ones, you know, that are in the academy or in a music school. It's music is there for everyone. It was, and it is, and it will be. And that's something that I rescue from John Cage. I completely agree with him. Music is a universal language, and music is for everyone, not only the special ones. So I remind you that if you have questions, just post them in the chat. We move forward. Thank you very much, John Cage. Now we move to the transsexual context with also a fantastic composer known as Wendy Carlos. There is this biography that Amanda Sewell wrote about Wendy. Wendy disappeared since a while now. I think she was not that happy on how people were perceiving transsexuality in general. However, she left us a lot of fantastic stuff. She's still alive. When we talk about Wendy Carlos, we are talking about transgender and trans musicality. Wendy is a pioneer popularizing the use of synthesizer, no, the so well-known MOC. She was first a physicist, and she was researching the meaning of timbre, a timbre researcher. She was a musician and also a sound recordist. This is a very important info. At some point, she met the Dr. Robert Mock, you know, the synthesizer Mock. She met the creator of the Mock, Robert Mock, and not long afterward, she began playing the Mock synthesizer. And she helped actually Dr. Bob Mock to create a touch sensitive keyboard and in the development of the vocoder. The vocoder is also a type of synthesizer, a machine that helps you to turn the voice as if you were talking as a robot. That's the vocoder. She had her first album known as Switch on Bach, which came out in 68, and where she turned classic music into electronic synth music. Wendy Carlos is, everyone knows Wendy Carlos, knowing it, and also when they don't know, even if they don't know Wendy, because her soundtracks, she worked very close to Stanley Kubrick, a very important filmmaker, as you know. And some of the films in which Wendy Carlos was producing a part of the soundtrack is The Shining by Kubrick, also A Clockwork Orange, and an excellent film for the people that love science fiction and cyberpunk, Tron. The first Tron, because there is a second Tron now, and the new one, I'm talking about the classic one, the first one, which I also recommend you to watch. It's an excellent film. And as I mentioned before, she has gone totally underground. She decided to get out of the light of the stage, and she left a little bit because, as I said, she was not that happy on how people perceive her as a transsexual musician. And that would be, I think she felt completely understood, misunderstood, and she was very unhappy with the situation with trans people, the transphobia going on. And unfortunately, she has not come back. She's still alive. However, let's watch Wendy Carlos. Let's meet her in person. Just a sec. This is Wendy Carlos in the BBC.
The development of modern electronics made it possible to recreate music from its component parts, its tones.
Well, you're looking at one of the very first 8-track machines. We used it for Switched On Bach, well-tempered synthesizer, right through a good half of Clockwork Orange.
Wendy Carlos, in her studio in Greenwich Village, is one of the pioneers of synthesized sound. Her controversial versions of the classics, created entirely electronically, put machine-made music on the map.
Right now, we're listening to the 8-track, and we're mixing, sort of playing the role of the conductor, putting together, in this case, a pair of tracks which has all of the string section that sounds like this. There's a harpsichord track, and two flutes, and there's this nice solo that's split up into two tracks. Let's put them all together. Needs a little more echo. Yeah, that's good.
Her early work was with a Moog synthesizer. Though it's a museum piece now, when it was first introduced, it opened the door to a world of music synthesis. It works by first generating these harsh, bright sounds made up of many pure tones played together.
We pass these bright waves into a filter, which in this case, literally like your tone controls on a hi-fi set, remove portions or boost portions of the sound. We can make it sound very dull, quite pure, or very bright. And you can do this dynamically in time, so sort of percussive, or make it open up, make it sit up there.
The Moog was revolutionary, but as it generated many tones together with little control, its sounds were crude. Soon, it was overtaken by a second revolution, controlling individual tones by computer.
Unlike the Moog synthesizer, we're not going to be taking away, tearing down bits of a very bright wave. Instead, we're going to put together little overtones, pieces of sounds, characteristic of all sounds, and assemble them additively rather than subtracting parts that we don't want.
By adding tones, one at a time, Wendy Carlos is able to build precisely the sound she wants. This is the beginnings of a xylophone.
Now, obviously, if we want to make it that sound like a xylophone, we're going to have to make it speak more quickly. So I'll shorten the attack from being about a half a second. There. Now it's getting on almost instantaneously, but it's lasting too long. Let me drop that down a bit. Ah, this is much more like a xylophone. Well, that one sounds pretty good. So I'll take that pattern and play a simple music phrase.
Now she specifies three more pure tones in the proportion she already knows a real xylophone produces.
Now I'll put in all four of them. Now, this is something that's very close to being a replica of a xylophone, but there's an element that's missing, and that is the hammer noise that you get with a real instrument when the mallet impacts against the wood.
For this final touch, she adds an electronic shake to each sound component.
Was Wendy Carlos. Also, something that I want to talk about in the case of trans musicality is that it is well known today that the trans people around the world are struggling a lot with violence. And I think, for instance, there was a game now coming out that we were waiting for a long time, which is for people that are interested in the cyberpunk approach. And people, you know, like some trans people were talking about making a critique to the game because they say like the game is basically very transphobic. And what I find very important when we talk about trans practice, I mean, in the sense of a trans person producing culture, is that, I don't know if you know, but for instance, the film The Matrix was produced by two sisters who are transsexual. And I think this is for me also very important because, for instance, Wendy Carlos, she decided to get out of the music scene and everything. She decided to stop because she was, I think, in pain and she felt like not really, I cannot talk for herself, but I have the feeling that she felt rejected, you know? And I think this is something quite common for many trans people, that they don't feel that we are really respecting and including and having a dialogue. You know, there is a lot of heterosexual violence towards trans people. And I think it's very important for us to talk about this kind of issues because for me, for instance, in the case of music, it's terribly sad to lose Wendy Carlos, because Wendy Carlos has been one of the most important electroacoustic electronic in the case of the use of synthesizers. I recommend you to check in with more time her works. She's just amazing, you know. And I feel extremely sad to see that a person coming from the trans perspective decide to leave because she felt misunderstood. So there is a lot of work that we have to do, and I don't know if there are if there is trans people today attending the workshop. I hope they are, and I encourage you to to really produce and to be present and to express your perspective, because it's extremely important. For me it is very important to say that, and to support also transsexuality and transsexual people, because at the end of the day, they are also human beings. They have rights. And as Wendy Carlos, they are also excellent cultural producers, and we have to include them too. We have to be community, you know. Okay, let's continue. That was a wonderful Wendy Carlos. Now we move on to Maria Chavez. Maria is a person that I almost crossed paths with in New York City. She was born in Peru. So now we are entering the background of Latin American composers. I am also myself Latin American. I was born in Mexico City. Maria Chavez was born in Lima, Peru. She is an improviser, a curator, and a song artist. She is very well recognized for her work as an abstract turntablist, turning the broken into sound art. And here, we are talking about what is for cyberpunk. That's how cyberpunk, we call it like this, accepting the glitch, you know, accepting and including the error. And that's what she does in her work as an abstract turntablist, which is like you will see in a little interview that we will watch, how she expressed that she breaks always things, you know, like with her hands, she's always breaking things. And she said like she was having troubles with that. And instead of feeling ashamed for breaking things, she decided to use those broken things and make something beautiful out of it. So metaphorically talking, this makes me think of trauma experience, you know, when a traumatic experience breaks your soul and you feel and walk towards your path broken. But what happens when you decide to deconstruct your trauma and to rescue and value and to accept it and to include it and to make something beautiful out of it? And I think that's what Maria Chavez is doing in the terrain of sound art, is accepting the broken and embracing the broken and doing something beautiful out of it. Chavez also uses new and broken needles on a collection of vinyl she uses to build a song palette. She also wrote a book, her first book. It is called Of the Technique, Chance Procedures on Turntable. And let's meet her. Let's get to know the work of Maria Chavez.
When I was a kid, if you gave me something, it always broke. I never wanted it to break, but it would just break. And so with time, I just began to realize, well, if everything's gonna break in my hands, I might as well make a career out of it.
500.
The act of turntablism itself, you could say it's the audacity to touch a playback technology in a way that it wasn't meant to be used as. And so as an abstract turntablist, I take it the next step over. I'm not interested in trying to create samples that make musical formations. I'm interested in pulling out moments and also incorporating chance and accidents into those moments in order for the sound pieces to create themselves, ultimately creating vibration sculptures. It starts as a perfect record in its sleeve, but eventually they just end up in my big pile of regular records that have no sleeves on them at all. And I have my regular vocabulary in a pile together so that they can rub up against each other and create new scratches and have like a little party in my record box. So then when I play them, there's these new scratches that I'm not even aware of that will, you know, shock me. And then I'll be like, oh, that wasn't there before. If they don't fit with the sound vocabulary that I have on my lap, then they get sacrificed. Normally, what I do is I place a record on my hip and then I snap it. From those shards, sometimes you get really lucky and one break will have the spindle hole still intact. And I call those records the most valuable break. And then you can layer quite a few on top of each other and create improvised music concrete sound collages.
Opened his mouth. He has people. Understood. He kept the dead. He cannot flourish in insubstance. He is left for now. Now, has not his genius. Has not his genius. So enough. Well known. Seven. Genius. So well known. So well known. Please, an attribute. Please. In our sagacity. In our sagacity. Has not he genius. He also let out.
Yes, that's the work of Maria Chavez. Something that I really love about her is how metaphorically, as I was saying before, the idea of there is no shame on being broken and on things that have dirt, on things that have break on things that we break sometimes. And she does also this type of alchemical work, which is as an artist, you know, turning the mistake into something positive. And that's something that we can rescue from Maria Chavez, which is really in our works. Sometimes the things that we hate become the most beautiful things that we do, actually. And that's something that I like to rescue about her work. And she's doing also, of course, at the moment, she's one of the contemporary composers, and she's also an educator. She teaches how to do abstract turntablism. And yeah, she's a person to check out. I recommend you to go and check more of her works on the platforms online. And we are coming to the end of the conference, and I wanna do a golden air end. As I mentioned, we are gonna go through questions. So if you still have some questions, you can just post them in the chat, and I will try to give you my perspective on the questions that you post. Now we move to our last person that is also part of the contemporary music production in the terrain of electroacoustic music, and that is Mota, a person that I also respect a lot. Mota, it's a person that works with poetry, a musician and an activist from Philadelphia in Pennsylvania. She talks about Black quantum futurism. This is very important because this idea of Black quantum futurism, it's a result of the work of Sun Ra, Afro-futurism. Yeah. What does Black quantum futurism mean? We're talking about a new language of healing, memory, and justice that can be transmitted and used as a technology, one that exists at the interaction of activism, art, and do-it-yourself culture. Mota has a very underground background. I think she used to live also in a house project and has a very long history in political activism. So when she is talking about healing memory, and this is again another electroacoustic producer that is going beyond merely an ego trip. You know, this is also a person that is more into trying to help somehow or to make an important political and social apportation to the universe and to the development of our society, you know. And as an Afro person, it's just like we need so much healing in this society. I can only agree with the movement of Black Lives Matter. It's so much ground that has been done, and I think also at the moment we also have a very violent period as well, and also for the LGBTQ community, it's just, and also the gender-based violence, even here in Germany as well. And all these issues about, you know, how the society is so divided and the elite, you know, the idea of some people, the hierarchies in class, and who access, for instance, now something interesting to look out is with the pandemic, is what is going to happen with the vaccines, you know, who is going to get the vaccine first, and all these questions that are around since a long time. But I think today through social media, we are realizing that there are still important questions that we have to ask. And I think cultural producers, we need to formulate those questions with our work, and we need to also not necessarily give answers, but we can give possibilities, and also we need to build a better futures. And for me, these type of conferences and workshops are extremely important because for me, education, it's sometimes what is changing the world, you know, and it's not only sometimes, it's what we need. We need education. We need to know all these people. We need to know that this list of white males is not the only list that we need to consider. There are other voices and other perspectives that also have a lot to say. And that is, in my case, my work. I believe absolutely in all these people that get into education. Because this is about knowledge, you know, and knowledge is power. And I think this is why, particularly for minorities, I think it's very, very important to reclaim our voices and to also to give visibility to our work and to support each other and to build up community and also to build up alliances. You know, it's not only about the bad and the good people, you know, it's a little bit more complex than that. But I think it's very beautiful if we can break borders, if we can collaborate with different type of human beings. That's for me the future, you know, like I love science fiction and cyberpunk and all these things. And for me, we are already in the future. And to me, a future, I cannot see a future in which I don't see transsexuals on a concert, or where I don't see gay people being paid properly, or when I don't see single mothers being also paid properly, you know. And I think we are building this type of society, and many people are against that type of society, and it's terrifying sometimes to see that people are still scared of gay people, you know. And I think there is a lot to do. So going back to Black Quantum Futurism, also she mentions, and I'm quoting her, in other words, is a version of Afrofuturism that is expressly for the people, especially the people who can afford to be online and who therefore are all too easy to overlook when you spend most of your time in the privileged dome of internet. This is also, as I said, more Moda is also in the corner of radical activism. Let's go, and I'm gonna show you a video about more Moda. Let me just a live performance, a little extract about that live performance. This is more Moda. That was just a little extract because we don't have a lot of time. I could spend all my many, many hours talking about all these wonderful people. But unfortunately, we don't have that much time. But I really hope that I could give you a general perspective about some of the most important people working from the past until up today. And let's now, to close our session, I wanna go to them to check a little bit the questions. Okay, let me see the questions here, and I'm gonna try to go one by one. We have a first question by Jessim. I don't know if I pronounce your name properly. Sorry if I don't. How come this song is good to that the audience could listen to all the sequence so well? That is interesting. Okay, this is, for me, I always, when I give workshops, you know, I also give workshops on electroacoustic composition, which is based on the importance of a piece that is composed properly. So time, concept, you know, language, historical context. And in these courses that I sometimes give to people in workshops or private lessons, I think how you keep the song good so the audience is with you, that's a kind of a, it has different answers to that question, because on that side, it depends, you know, like it depends what type of music you are doing. And also it depends who are you, what's your goal with the product, with your music. Because sometimes when you want to be popular, you know, like, then you have to, it depends, you know, like there is, for instance, the case of pop music, you know. Pop is extremely popular because it's very digestible. Everyone can digest pop music, you know. But if you play them John Cage, that's a different story. You know, like some people hate the Wata Walk, you know, because they are like, oh my God, how can he be breaking things, breaking radios, and you know, like that's not music. And you know, that's always, I think in my case, it's very important as a person, as a music producer, that you know what you are doing and why you are doing it, you know, that you have a certain kind of content. And these people that I show you today, I choose them because they are in different levels, extremely developed, you know, they even create philosophy, you know, and they are social active, and they transform society with the things they do. So it's, these people are just giants, you know. And for me, I really, really defend the idea of Sonra, when Sonra says, like, you have no limits, you know, just expand. And that's just basically Renaissance, you know, if you ask me, like, be a Leonardo da Vinci, you know, like, just explore, do theater, do music, write, explore photography, you know, and research. It's so important that we also learn from others, you know. In my case, I mean, I have many of my people, friends, collaborators, they are all excellent people who I also learn from there. I have writers around me, I have scientists around me. And whenever I have a question regarding anything, like regarding music, or maybe regarding, like, you know, like for instance, now with Corona, you know, all these things, like people saying that Corona does not exist and blah, blah, blah. And then I have a friend who is a virologist, and I went and I told him, like, tell me, what is this going on here, you know? And I always try to learn and ask certain questions to people, journalists, sociologists, anthropologists, and also read and buy books, and also listen a lot to different type of music in order for me to produce better music. And I watch a lot of documentaries. And so in my lessons, when I do workshops on composition, I try to teach the people that is very important to know what are you doing and why are you doing it. And also to understand that your intention, that's also very important. If your intention is an ego trip to be famous, that's for me not interesting at all. That's for me. That's what that type of people don't interest me. There are many, plenty of them. But when we are talking about people that are even in a spiritual trip, that's a different thing, you know? And these people are not necessarily always popular. Why are they not popular? Because they are not doing things in order to be famous, and they are not doing things in order to, they go deeper, you know? And to me, it's more beautiful when you go deeper, you know? Another question for Carl. Sorry if I don't pronounce the names correctly. Come Mac Alistair. What are some rules and taboos that the new composer should be breaking? Well, for instance, the taboo of transsexuality, that's a taboo that we should be and need to be breaking. You know, like I think in the music industry, also another taboo, which is gender violence in the music industry. There has been a lot of scandals lately about people using their careers in order to, you know, have sex with people. And there is nothing wrong, don't get me wrong. There is nothing wrong about sexuality. I think it's part of us and we have to embrace it. I think more the discussion was about consent, you know? And I think those discussions are also belong to the music production scene. We need also to ask certain questions about our ethics and, you know, which ethics do we hold, you know, and what do we support? Do we support, for instance, the killing of animals or I don't know, the use of bioenergy? Or as I said, what is my position towards gender violence when I am, for instance, a heterosexual male producer? Or as in general, as a scene, what is our position towards transsexual music producers, you know? And these are topics that normally people are not that, they don't wanna talk about. There are many, many producers that avoid this type of topics. And the reason is because they don't wanna be criticized and they don't want to lose followers. And I have seen many people that in order to get more likes on Instagram, they basically become pop stars. You see, like they don't want to put important topics on the table. And that's okay, no, because I cannot tell a producer how they have to live their lives, you know, and how do they have to approach their music. But I think for me, I am a fan of radical people who are very intelligent and who research and who, as you are saying, break certain taboos, you know, the taboo of sexuality, homosexuality, and different, there are so many different things, you know, like we can talk about it, but that's when we go in the terrain of content and research and knowledge, you know, that's when we go deeper as only playing a record. You can just play a record and think like, oh my God, this is a wonderful composition. You know, that's one thing, one level. But another level is who produced that record and under which circumstances is this record produced and who is the producer behind that record. That's, you know, and that's when, to me, the theme becomes quite interesting when you start realizing like, oh my God, this is Ludwig van Beethoven. And he could not listen. And he produced like this kind of punk because it's super hardcore, these compositions that he did, very dark, you know? And then it's when the person becomes interesting. For me, those are also the taboos that we should break. The idea that a music producer is only that. I think we should break that interpretation and we should go a little bit further and ask questions to the musicians, you know, to know a little bit more about who is behind the cultural production. Another question from Isabella Siqueira. Who will be the John Cage of our generation? Is a creative way of composing, in the creative way of composing, I mean. Well, the problem, that's also something that I'm, it might sound a little bit arrogant, but you know, like I really have a strong passion for song and music production and the history of it. I don't know a lot. I mean, you know, it's like Socrates. I only know that I don't know nothing. The more I read, the less I know. Believe me, there's so much to learn. I want to be humble and modest. I really don't know as I wish. My life is not enough to know a lot. But from when what I know, there is something that is, it can be a little bit sad, if you want, but that's something that I sometimes tell to my students in the workshops, which is like, if you look at the history of music, actually everything has been already done. There is nothing new that you can do, you know. There are certain things that are new, which are the medium is becoming new. For instance, now you have people more working with, which is also not new, but they are just developing, for instance, artificial intelligence, you know, virtual reality and all these things, more towards music and technology, you know. For instance, yesterday I saw a performance by an Australian and working in collaboration with a German woman, and they were, they produced these tiny robots. They are like, the size of two hands together, and they made everything from the robot, also everything, you know. They built up everything and they programmed the robot, they made the chips for the robot, they everything. And these little robots produced are for an interactive performance, and you can, the person can through internet play the robot, and there are different mini robots, these little robots producing very abstract tunes. The performance was very beautiful. It's very abstract music, and it's, you are playing the robot via internet. That's something, for instance, relatively new. But in general, it's like, I think there is nothing that we could say like, oh my God, this is totally, totally, totally new. I don't know what will that be. And in my case, it's because I am a follower of science fiction in movies, for instance, you know. So through film, I have seen already the future. And you see, you know what I mean? So it's quite hard to think like, okay, today we have, who will be a John Cage? I think John Cage did it, you know, and today it's everything already done, basically. But what we can do is absolutely be more inclusive in what we do. I think it's very, very important to give this type of workshops about the history of music and give visibility, the visibility to people, to minorities, you know. And I think that's not overdone, you know? That's something that is really, really missing. And I think that that's something relatively new that we can do, which is like acknowledging. What I mean by that is like giving the credits to people that are doing amazing stuff. And that will be my answer. I hope that will be acceptable as an answer, but debatable for sure. Laura Balboa, thanks for this, Veronica. Can you mention one positive and one negative experience you have had as Latin American woman researcher or as a song producer and artist? Ah, yes, of course, I have a list of both. In my case, I have to say I am pansexual. That, for instance, already it's kind of a thing. Something positive. Well, let's start with the negative. Yeah, the negative is the cliches. You know, like so people sometimes see me. When I was younger, I come from the punk underground scene in Mexico City, and of course, I had my spikes, like, you know, like the totally British punks in London. You know, I had this type of looks, and I had, of course, in the 90s, to be like that in Mexico City as a woman was so radical. You know, so I was constantly bullied by people on the streets and cops, and you know, but I did not care because I was different, you know. And something is like people think that because I have long hair, or now I let my hair grow and I look a little bit femme, that people, and because I come from Mexico, people think that I am homophobic, no? Homophobic and probably married to a heterosexual guy. And I don't know, people sometimes think or that I don't know what kind of music thing they produce, like mariachi music or God fucking knows. And, you know, like this for me sometimes is painful because that's not how I live my life, you know? And it's basically the BS going on there, you know? Also, I have had people thinking that because I live in Germany, I am kind of, you know, that I am rich, you know, that I am, that I have a lot of money and that my parents have money. And people assume that I am kind of a rich person when I am not. I have a working class background, you know, and it's like, so, but this is the bias of people and people see what they wanna see. And sometimes it has been painful, particularly in when people assume my sexual identity and when also people think that I am a super conservative person, that for me is like, if they will see me operating as a Specta Negra, one of my projects, they will freak out, you know. It will be like, oh my God, she doesn't have nothing as I was thinking as a Latin American woman, you know. I'm very, very different as sometimes people think. And that's the negative aspect. Positive aspect, I tell you one story that is nice. I remember here in Berlin once going to get my visa. And I was very terrified because I was scared not to get in a prolonged time. And I went there and the person, the German person looking at my visa and my permit, this person told me like, oh, you look like Frida Kahlo, you know. And Frida Kahlo is the connection between Mexico and Germany because Frida Kahlo has a Jewish German background. For me, that was a beautiful experience because I got the visa, you know, because the person told me you look like Frida Kahlo and I love Frida Kahlo. And then she put the stamp on my passport. And I was like, thank you, Frida Kahlo. Thank you because you opened me the doors, you know. But that's also, again, kind of BS as well, you know, like, oh, Frida Kahlo, Mexico, Frida Kahlo. And it's not only Frida Kahlo. There are many other fantastic painters in Mexico. But in the terrain of music, I must say, more specific, not that biographical in another aspects like my visa, but going more in the terrain of music. Sorry if I lost a little bit the track. A negative experience has been misogyny. Misogyny has been a strong aspect in certain terrains. What for me is sometimes very shocking is that sometimes is younger generations as mine. You know, and I have realized that even if it's sometimes people that are trying to be like progressive, or I'm talking about the heterosexual culture, by the way, but also in the gay culture, sometimes it depends. I mean, it's like, I don't want to generalize and put again bias as well, but I have had experiences in which, for me, I produce industrial music as well. And industrial music is a very male heterosexual dominated terrain. And it has taken many, many years for me to establish, you know. Why? Because I am a woman and because they perceive me as such. And also because my project is quite political. And sometimes people feel annoyed by the fact that I am making political music. And when I formulate certain questions, some people dislike that, you know. Some people just want to have fun, you know, and I respect that, you know. But in my case, life is not only about having fun. Of course, fun is important, but for me, what matters the most is to have content in what we do and to share, of course, knowledge. So I hope I answered your questions, guys. I really appreciate the time that you took for being in this workshop. I wanna thank again, guys, for this conference and for the program. They put together an amazing program. And if you have any question, you can also find me in the page of Urban Arts Berlin. And I hope you enjoy the conference. I hope that I could give you something new that you could use for your research or for your music production. And yes, it was very, very nice to be here. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye-bye.